Okay, so today's webinar, the title is "Are there better options than savings accounts?" The whole idea here today is, opening up a savings account is the first step towards, or the starting point towards achieving your financial goals. Savings accounts are ideal for building a nest egg. I always say it's starting capital. You're building your starting capital. But also, it ensures what I call financial discipline. Having a debit order in place and that regular amount going into your savings account, it does instill a measure of discipline. But saying that, you can see the subtitle there is a quote from Tennessee Williams. You can be young without money, but you can't be old without it. So that is a challenge when it comes to savings accounts. Savings accounts are not the best place to invest your money if you're looking for high returns, especially in today's high inflation rate environment. That's number one. And number two, obviously, today's webinar is to focus on looking at alternatives to a savings account. And obviously, something can give you much more returns than a savings account. Please understand that I'm not knocking a savings account. As I say, it is a I call it a tool. It's a tool within your toolbox. You can look at it as an arrow in your quiver. But saying that, he has a quote from Robert G. Allen. He's someone I do respect. He's as a great. I like his books. I've got quite a few of his books. How many millionaires do you know who have saved, who've become wealthy by investing in savings accounts? I rest my case. So please understand, I'm not knocking savings account. It's a tool. But you can do better somewhere else. You need to have a savings account to build up that starting capital, but you can do better. So before going a bit further, let's just put us into a bit of context while we're talking about savings accounts. Over the last few weeks, even months now, we've been talking about the uncertainty and the volatility in the markets, and that's an ongoing theme. Take it back a bit, investors around the world. Well, we've had our fair share of volatile and uncertain markets in an environment where there's significant political events, both here and abroad. Talk about Brexit, we can talk about the upcoming US elections, but also we've gone through a period of unexciting growth prospects, as well as obviously persistently low interest rates. Yeah, in South Africa, we've seen our currency reach, going back a few months now, obviously 17 rand to the dollar earlier this year, amidst our own political upheaval. Obviously, we're still around the corner from a possible ratings downgrade, as well as obviously a large-scale emerging market sell-off. Since then, yes, we've seen the rand has strengthened all the way back to pre-Nene Gate levels. But saying that, there's three scenarios that we could pick out. Many investors have chosen either to sell off their riskier assets, so the stocks that are overvalued, and are sitting on a lot of cash. I've seen that a lot of our clients are sitting on a lot of cash. That's the first scenario. Many of the investors are moving as much of their funds they can offshore. By the way, next week we're talking about offshore investing. And the third scenario, and this is where quite interesting also, a lot of people are looking for the safe haven. Where can I park my money and wait for the volatility or the uncertainty to go away? I don't know about that part, but there's a lot of people waiting to see what happens. It's wait and see attitude. So that just puts a bit of into context. So what is the current situation when it comes to savings? I spoke about this a few weeks ago, but South Africans are saving, but not enough, and not necessarily in the right places. Our savings efforts are being hampered by number one, the obviously a lack of financial literacy, consumerism, and unemployment. Despite these challenges, millions of us do save, through our pension funds and informal savings each month. But South Africa's this is comes through from the Institute of Savings. South Africa's official savings rate at the end of March 2016, so it's a bit out of date, but I don't think it has changed a lot, was 15%. Our household savings rate was 1.1%. Scary stuff, eh? And our debt as a percentage of disposable income was 76.6%. So these numbers show a little reason to celebrate. But saying that, they do represent a slight improvement. Our previous figures show that debt to disposable income was 80%. So we've had a 3.4% improvement, whereas our savings as a, it was below 1%. So we've seen a slight improvement there. So in addition to these small gains, the informal savings have continued to increase. We've seen that assets under management, this is in the collective investment schemes industry, totals nearly 2 trillion rand. Okay, and the pension fund industry holds nearly 4 trillion in assets. So it's quite a, we are saving. So while we bemoan our low savings rate and say we are appearing to save. But saying that is, there are many people that do not save enough, especially when it comes to emergency funds and things like that. And we've seen a trend. We see the of our clients, when it comes to emergency, something happens, they dip into their retirement funds. So that's quite scary. So saying that, there are some reasons for low savings. Low savings environment is it's easy to identify. Of the big problem there is obviously unemployment, which is over 25%. It's nearly impossible to save anything if you're unemployed. It's difficult to save anything. In addition, obviously, many families spend large amounts on private sector education and healthcare. I find myself in that boat, and with very little left over for savings. And over the years, I've learned one of the key rules for myself was to pay myself first and wouldn't pay my investments first. That helps me eliminate that. So the less obvious reasons for low savings relate to poor literacy, financial literacy, and obviously the rise of conspicuous consumerism. If you can see us over here, I shop, therefore I am. Okay, which encourages obviously instant gratification no matter what the cost. By the way, what I mean by financial literacy, it's the education and understanding of various financial areas. The focus is typically on the ability to manage your personal finances, in a more efficient manager manage manner rather. This includes knowledge of making appropriate decisions about personal finance and things such as investing and insurance and real estate, paying off for university, budgeting, retirement, and obviously tax planning. When it comes to conspicuous consumerism, yeah, we're talking about we're referring to consumers who pay for expensive items to display wealth and income rather than to cover their real needs of the consumer. And some of you might have come across this quote before, and this is Dave Ramsey. I referred to him a few weeks ago. He's a talk show host in the States, and I like this one. And he says, "We buy things we don't need with money we don't have to impress people we don't like." Okay. So anyway, that's just putting a bit into context. So what's the ideal situation? Now, the ideal situation is obviously, and this is one of my philosophies with my children, is to start teaching them money skills at a very early age. If we can start improving our savings, I think things will be much better. But we can achieve for adults, improving savings can be achieved through what is called auto-enrollment. Auto-enrollment is used a lot in the pension funds. It's accepted as a condition of employment at many employers. So that's one way. It's like a debit order. Imagine a debit order. It just makes savings automatic. So the idea is that if you make it automatic, makes it easier. That's number one. And the far more controversial stance is this what they call compulsory preservation. Last week we spoke about preservation funds, but this compulsory preservation of retirement savings and annuitization. In other words, when it comes to retirement, when you leave your job, the retirement savings are automatically preserved unless you obviously make another choice. So that, yes, we've seen it really. The labor unions are obviously resisting this. This legislation's been postponed till next or 2018, in fact. But the whole idea is that if you want a tax incentive, you must preserve and annuitize. And that's how the whole call it markets are set up. That's the one side of the coin. The other side of the coin is having a default situation, especially when it comes to investment strategies, as I say, preservation or resignation and annuities. That retirement is one way. It just means that your first choice is made by a system. And people are, you know, we find that people tend to live with a choice the system makes for them. And obviously, you still can obviously overrule it as an individual. So, yeah. The whole idea is, you know, if you look at the successful introduction of what we call the tax-free investment plan or tax-free savings accounts last year, it has encouraged people to save. And it proves beyond a doubt that with the right motivation, South Africans can and do save. So, yeah, that gives you some of some background there, the ideal situation. So, it's having an investment plan for various outcomes in your life. Short term, medium term, and long term, but also various financial vehicles, you know, be it shares, bonds, or whatever the case might be. So, before we get into the nitty-gritties, if I had a magic wand, maybe what magic wand is okay, ideal position, but let's look at the ideal investment. What would be a perfect investment? So, when I talk about a perfect investment, it'd be very difficult to find something like that. But you'd be in a situation, you'd be rich as Jan Rupert. You have to worry about money for a single minute. But if you had to wonder whatever, what would make up a perfect investment? There's five criteria that you can look at. First of all, obviously, a perfect investment, I'm looking for something that's going to give me high returns. Something's going to hopefully either give me no, I don't have to pay taxes or low taxes to be completely safe. It will have absolute or always liquid and obviously be totally passive. Those are the five criteria I'd look at. Well, you can ideally identify, you can use it as a template and it gives you that opportunity to look at it this way. Give you opportunity to think about these five attributes and to determine which ones are really most important to you. And from that, you can figure out what types of investment choices are a good fit for you. So that gives you that kind of introduction. So high rate of return, compound rate of return that outperforms inflation, taxes, and other investment alternatives. In an ideal situation, the return should be guaranteed and risk-free. Imagine that. Low taxes tied up to the high returns. The return should not carry any tax consequences, any or no tax consequences. You would get to keep everything that the investment earned. Imagine that. Complete safety. Yeah, we're talking about no concern of any part of the investment can ever be lost. Imagine that. And fourth scenario, liquidity. The ability to redeem the investment for cash or to be able to get your money out at any time without cost or penalty. Imagine that. And obviously, total passivity. You don't need any special skill or knowledge required to make the investment. In other words, no active management would be required from your part. In other words, you could just forget about your investment and enjoy life. Okay. So, since we know perfection doesn't exist, and we don't expect to be able to meet all these five criteria in every investment decision. You know, for example, if you want absolute safety, you know, I'm willing to forego some return. You know, but you know, the idea is that you might want to let go of one or two of these criteria, but as long as we meet the other three criteria, that's the whole idea. But saying that, you know, she'd always emphasize quality. We've spoken about this in many other webinars. Quality. This is where if your investment doesn't have enough safety or doesn't give you enough return or enough liquidity, you know, I'll pass on the investment, go past it, and we'll avoid that investment. So complete safety is something that does not exist. You know, I talk about inflation risk and all that kind of stuff. But when you find an investment that approaches very close to it, you found something that carries high value. Liquidity is the easiest of all these five criteria. This is a perfect characteristic to find. It's available in stocks and bonds and commodity futures and single stocks and things like that. The biggest one that you can't escape is taxes. You know, it's inescapable, but it is possible to grow your wealth without constantly generating a taxable event. In other words, being a buy and hold investor. Remember, capital gains tax is much lower than income tax. Passivity. Total passivity, I think it's often the function of how well the other four criteria were met. Now, if you choose well, you can sit comfortably and let your money grow with time. If you're chosen poorly, you could lose sleep and money. And obviously, that's where you have to rely on liquidity to get that get liquidity in the market to get out of your investment. So as long as you've chosen well, passivity is not difficult. Diversified portfolio, be it geographically or just here in South Africa. But the old saying goes, the old adage goes, if it ain't broke, you need to have the peace of mind and yes, the discipline not to fix it. So if that's working for you, that's it. Yeah. Just understand there's no perfect investment. But if you can have these criteria, that's what you're looking for. So how do we get there? What are we proposing today? So we're going to talk about unit trust. So we've been talking about savings. So I'm going one step up from a savings plan. I'm still focusing on that, call it the passive stance. So unit trust, yes, is one step up from that. So I just want to give those of you that are complete novices or still maybe considering unit trust. I'm going to give you a quick basic overview. What is a unit trust and things like that. But unit trusts allow a large group of people to pool their money into the JSE or money markets. Your investments are spread, so the overall risk in trading on the JSE is reduced. That's one of the main drawcards. Each unit trust is managed by a fund manager, and obviously this requires a certain minimum amount. Our minimum amount here at PSG Wealth is 500 rand per month by debit orders. But the whole idea for those of you that are beginners. We always advise, you're to get involved in growth or value funds, because they usually offer a much decent return than a savings account. But looking at this slide here, first tier classification, we talk about the four major portfolios. You've got a South African portfolio, worldwide portfolio, global portfolio, and regional portfolios. Okay, South African portfolio invests at least 70% of the assets in South Africa investment markets. You may invest a maximum of 25% of your assets outside of Africa, plus 5% of assets in Africa, excluding South Africa. Worldwide funds, this is where there's no limit set for either domestic or foreign markets. Global portfolios, and so this is what we'll be talking about next week, invest at least 80% of the assets outside South Africa with no more than 80% exposure to assets in a specific geographical region. Then regional portfolios of investing at least 80% of the assets outside South Africa in a specific geographic region, including Africa, other than South Africa. So that's the first tier of classification when it comes to unit trusts. Go one step further. The second tier of classification, yeah, we talk about interest-bearing portfolios, equity portfolios, multi-asset, and in real estate. So you can break down interest-bearing portfolios. A lot of us know it as either money market accounts, money market funds, fixed interest, or income funds. And you can see there with the range. Remember, they're not investing in any equities or any real estate or any cumulative preference shares. So that excludes that and anything to do with the interest-bearing securities. Equity portfolios. Invest a minimum of 8% of the fund in equities, and the whole focus here is obviously capital appreciation. Multi-asset or balanced portfolios are very popular. This is where you invest in a wide spread of investments, bonds, money market, property markets. That's a whole spread there, and it's just a class by itself. Real estate, you can see there. Investing listed property, property loan stock, and real estate investments. So that just gives you a quick insight into it. Here's a quote from Susie Orman. Some of you might have heard of Susie Orman. Cash in savings accounts or money market deposit is great for emergency fund. But to fulfill a long-term investment goal like funding for your retirement, consider buying stocks. And there I've inserted because of the talk today, unit trust. The more distant your financial target, your retirement, the long inflation will gnaw at the purchasing power of your money. Yeah. So that just puts it into a bit of perspective for you. So what will this do for you? What are the benefits? Now, unit trust, as I say, it's been long considered as a low rate of risk, as well as obviously low return investment. Why I say that? You'll find that, you don't need Do you have a lot of time or the money required to invest in the stock market? Those are the two main criteria for a lot of people. Don't have the time, don't have the money, and obviously that's where you need to consider unit trust. Just a simpler and more effective way of saving money over time. What's nice about unit trust, you're not putting all your eggs in one basket. You don't need to have in-depth knowledge of the market. And obviously, it's also, as I say, it's a perfect way to build a balanced investment portfolio. Okay, so what will unit trust do for you? First, there's five criteria we could always look at, five benefits. Professional investment management. You got a fund manager that does it for you, so your money's in safe hands. Remember, it's all regulated by the Financial Services Board. What are the big draw cards for unit trust? Obviously, diversification. The investment risk is spread. Ease of transactions, it's easy to get in and out of the market. Security, remember there's a trustee and the fund manager has to stick to the mandate. And obviously it's also affordable and flexible. You don't need huge amounts of money to invest in big assets. So those are the big benefits. I think the biggest disadvantage or the biggest drawdown for a lot of people is how long must I keep the investment? And you must think of unit trust as long term. They are not short term investments. You need to keep your unit trust for a period of at least between 3 and 5 years to see a satisfactory return. But also, obviously, the wide range. A lot of people are overwhelmed by the amount of funds available. How do I choose them? And we'll discuss it in the next few slides. So you should also understand that unit trust is a way, other ways of looking at getting involved in unit trust. In the past, we have discussed these other investment products, the tax-free investment plan, as well as the retirement annuity. So when it comes to contributions with unit trust, you can get involved there with 500 rand debit order, or you add piece to your wealth, we take a lump sum of 20,000. Tax-free investment plan, 500 rand a month, maximum. Remember, you're limited to 30,000 rand a year. 2,500 rand a month, if you look at it that way. RAs, this is compulsory money. 500 rand debit order, or minimum which we take on is 20,000 rand lump sum. Remember, with retirement annuity, going one step further than just normal unit trust, your premiums, your contributions are tax deductible. Okay, up to 27.5% of your annual income, with a maximum limit of 350,000. So that's is a big one compared to over here, just putting your money there, not getting any tax benefits. Admin fees is the same for everything across the board here. If it's looking at PSG funds, it's 0.2% plus VAT for PSG funds. Non-PSG funds, our admin fees are 0.5%. That's for the first 1.5 million, and it slides down over 1.5 million to slides down to 0.28%. Okay, taxation. From a capital gains point of view, the exclusion on unit trust, your first 40,000 is tax free. That's excluded. Remember, tax free, all your income tax, your capital gains tax, and dividend withholding tax is non-existent. You don't pay any tax on that. It's tax free. That's the advantage there. When it comes to retirement annuities, your first 500,000, this is after obviously the retirement age of 55, your first 500,000 is tax free. The other two thirds has to be used for compulsory annuity, but then we work on what they call tax tables. Comes to restrictions, you can withdraw the money whenever you want to, anytime. There's no restriction on what you want to invest in. That's advantage here. When it comes to tax free, you have to stick to what we call clean class. And again, you can withdraw any time, but just remember you can't just put that money back. You've got limitations there. When it comes to retirement annuities, you have to stick to Regulation 28 guidelines, as well as you can't withdraw anything before your age of 55. Okay, so there's other ways of using unit trusts. So this is what PSG offers. This is our range of funds. We've got over 12, well, 12 funds to choose from. You can see also that we have a clean class that you can use for your tax free. Okay, so those will fit into that category. Those of you for your RAs, you can see we got three that'll be, or four actually, that'll comply to Regulation 28 guidelines. Okay. By the way, if you can click on this here to take you right through to the page where you can download the whole fund list. Okay, and that's what the fund list look like. It is now updated now the 1st of September. As I said just now, there's over 1,000 funds on the market here at PSG on our PSG Wealth platform. We offer 450 funds. Most of these funds obviously will be chasing the same investments. The biggest challenge for most people, how do you narrow down your choice? And on our website, we have a thing called Funds A to Z. It helps you just to sift or filter through funds. And then from there, you can obviously do further investigation. But they, again, you can click up top here, take you through to the link, and be able to use it as a tool. Yeah. So guys, I hope that helps you a bit. When it comes to PSG funds, I mentioned just now, obviously our ongoing platform 0.2%, other funds 0.5%. Okay. Let's see what kind of questions you guys have for us today. Cool. Okay. I'm just sorry, I'm reading a long question. Ken Shears can send me a long question here. If the market crashes, everything goes down, the good, the bad, and the ugly. Would you advise having a high percentage in cash in the current worldwide economic environment? And yeah, Ken, I said a lot of the guys, there's those three scenarios. People are getting, are moving to cash. They're selling off their riskier assets, especially the out in the share portfolio. A lot of the guys are getting out of the more expensive industrial shares. A lot of them are the rand hedges. They are seriously overvalued. So they're getting rid of those and moving into cash, waiting for the opportunity. You know, it's a difficult one. You know, we're not talking about timing the market. It's always time in the market. And yes, we're talking about one asset class here. Call it a paper assets. You go one step further. You can look at physical property, commodities, be it gold or platinum or silver or cryptocurrencies. Go one step further. Also having businesses. Those are the four main asset classes. If we had to use Robert Kiyosaki's classification, but it is volatile. It is uncertain times. But you know, if you've, as I mentioned just now, if you've chosen carefully, you've got good quality stocks and good quality investments, ride it out, Ken. So I think that's the only way I can give you advice there. I think the question here from William. If I am below 30 years of age, what breakdown percentages would you give between a share portfolio, unit trust, savings account, and other financial instruments with a growth mindset given my age? The younger are, William, the younger you are, the more risk you can take. So you must be focused on growth assets, you know, be it shares or high equity unit trusts. You know, putting a small percentage in cash, yeah, for emergency funds. I think that's the only way to look at it. But I'll be focused on growth assets big time. Okay. Looks like it's most of the questions. Cool. Okay, so let's just wrap this up quickly. What in conclusion, you know, savings account, as I mentioned right in the beginning, is the first step to reaching your financial goals. It's a good way to start building what I call starting capital. It also helps you ensure your financial discipline. But it's not a place to invest if you're looking for high returns. Remember, we spoke about the perfect investment. Just understand there's no perfect investment, but you can also use it as a guideline, as a template. There's five criteria. From PEG side, you know, consider our range of funds. We offer a lot of flexibility, and obviously our costs are quite affordable. Okay, so guys, what are your next action steps? Those of you that haven't got any unit trust with PSG yet, you can click on that link to take you to our pages there and learn more about what we offer there, tax-free as well as retirement annuities. Okay, as I said, the recording will be sent out hopefully by tomorrow, at the latest by Friday. Okay, next week. We're talking about how to minimize political risk. So yes, how do I gain offshore exposure? either taking my money offshore or converting my rand into something else. The week after that, we're talking about ETPs, exchange traded funds. The week after that, we're talking about do you want different income in your portfolio? And then we into October. Okay. But guys, thanks a lot for being on this webinar. There's my contact details. If you guys have any questions, my email address as well as our number. You can also always get a hold of our clients, our sales desk, and Henny and Clint is always there to help you. But from my side, thank you very much for being on this webinar. Until next week, all the best. Bye for now.